Je passerai la parole à monsieur le professeur Philippe Gierand, qui va parler dans les langues nationales disponibles. Monsieur Bühler, tout à l'heure, a déconseillé de vouloir prescrire au service provider comment, quel SLA il devrait utiliser. Donc, en fait, il a déconseillé de vouloir négocier un SLA. Mais vous, vous allez nous apprendre que non seulement ça a du sens, mais surtout comment on le fait. Merci beaucoup.
Merci beaucoup. Bonjour à toutes et à tous. Donc d'abord, je suis très heureux d'être, je crois, le seul roman, en tout cas, dans les orateurs. Alors, je ne veux pas compromettre la paix confédérale, n'est-ce pas ? Mais je sais très bien que pour certains, surtout dans le domaine IT, au fond, l'anglais est une langue de travail peut-être plus courante quand même que le français, peut-être même que l'allemand. Donc c'est la raison pour laquelle simplement je proposais de faire mon exposé qui, lui, dans les slides, à tout le moins, est en français, en anglais, parce qu'effectivement, ça ne me pose pas de problème. Par contre, je dois reconnaître que auf Hochdeutsch ist es schon ein bisschen schwieriger et Schweizerdeutsch gar nicht. Donc voilà. Donc je vais faire simplement mon introduction en français et puis ensuite de quoi la partie plus substantielle, je la ferai en anglais. Alors peut-être d'abord un petit disclaimer, si je peux dire, c'est qu'en tant qu'avocat praticien, je traite essentiellement avec une clientèle privée, plus que publique, et qui plus est du côté essentiellement du client plus que du vendeur. Bon. Cela a certaines incidences. Il est vrai qu'on ne peut pas véritablement négocier à proprement parler beaucoup de SLA. Néanmoins, pour les raisons que je vais expliquer en introduction, il est évident que les SLA ont un rôle essentiel dans l'univers du cloud, puisqu'ils sont quand même garants de la performance du système, et à ce titre méritent un examen attentif qui potentiellement peut quand même influencer le choix que l'on peut avoir d'un fournisseur ou un autre. Et donc, typiquement, dans le domaine privé, on parle de request for proposal, c'est un élément qui est important et où on peut quand même définir un certain nombre de critères, quitte ensuite, à ma foi, à devoir faire son choix. Alors, de quoi vais-je parler ? Bon, quelques remarques d'abord introductives, et puis je vais discuter de certains points qui semblent nécessité de retenir plus particulièrement effectivement l'attention lors de la lecture d'un SLA. Il y a ce qu'on appelle la disponibilité du service, le temps de réponse, les questions de mise à jour, on verra que dans le cloud, évidemment, c'est un peu particulier, la gestion des incidents et enfin quelques remarques conclusives sur la gouvernance. Alors, je terminerai la partie en français sur ces remarques introductives. C'est qu'au début, lorsque j'ai commencé à négocier des contrats informatiques, on va dire, beaucoup de clients disaient, et ça remonte quand même à 8 ou 9 ans, disaient « Ah non, le cloud, en tout cas pas, on perd le contrôle de nos données, etc. Il en est hors de question, etc. etc. » Aujourd'hui, évidemment, le monde a profondément changé et je dirais que non seulement on n'est pas réticent à aller vers le cloud, mais qu'au contraire, on a même une tendance à préférer le cloud, au point même que beaucoup de fournisseurs aujourd'hui n'ont même plus de solutions on-premise et ont uniquement des applications cloud. L'intérêt est évident, hein, la flexibilité, scalability, etc., etc., etc. Mais la dépendance que ça peut entraîner à l'égard d'un tiers a pour conséquence, évidemment, que on a un moins bon contrôle de ces données et que du même coup, on doit se montrer d'autant plus rigoureux en termes d'annexes au contrat. Et là, je pense notamment à la protection des données qui vient d'être évoquée, question de sécurité, hein, les certifications, etc. Mais aussi, et ce sera l'objet de cette présentation, de ce qui est justement Service Level Agreement. And now I'll switch to English. So, the first key point with regard to SLA relates to the availability of the service. Obviously, a key question is to find out how that availability is measured. It is quite standard in the industry not to take into account the scheduled maintenance, which is a different thing if you have unscheduled maintenance, such as a security bug, etc., which may not count as an unavailability. The rate of availability will depend. It will depend upon the type of service. Is it business critical? Is it not business critical? Do you include maintenance windows in that calculation or not? If it is business critical, it is now not an exception to have a 99.9% of availability required. But obviously, then that rate needs to be measured with regard to the periodicity of the calculation. So if you have, which is not common, but let's say to take an example, a daily measurement, and that you have a 99% availability, which is actually pretty low, it means that the system can be done a bit more than 14 minutes in a day. Okay. However, if you measure that same availability rate of 99% over a monthly basis, it means that your service can be done 446 minutes in a row, which is potentially more than 7 hours. Okay. And if you have, I don't know, in a supply chain environment, for instance, or chain of or production line, obviously that makes a huge difference. And typically, I once had a client who came to me and said, yeah, a vendor, for 4 hours in a row, the system was down, etc. They didn't do anything. And I said, yeah, but if you make the calculation of your SLA, you cannot do anything. Okay, maybe he consumed the whole set in 3 hours or 4 hours, but you cannot do anything. So a good point, if you can, is to say that the system can be done only for a certain lapse of time within a single day. But there you need some leverage, pretty strong leverage, and it's not always easy to get. Since the maintenance windows are not only, generally not counted towards an availability, you want to agree on their periodicity. You may say, okay, but no more than once per month, for instance. About the duration of that maintenance window, it should not be more, for instance, than 3 hours in a row. And obviously, the time when it happens. So you will try and say on a Sunday between 2 a.m. and 5 a.m., if you have operations worldwide in a zone which is less affected business-wise from such maintenance windows. By the way, I have actually drafted a paper in English related to the presentation. I don't know if you got it or not, if it was provided to you or not. If that's not the case, I'm either happy to share it to you if you ask me, or I have submitted it normally to the organizer who should have it in hand as well. Okay. So feel free to ask me or the organizer, and normally they should be able to send it to you. Obviously, it's good to have availability rates, but if you have no credits in case of failure, these make little sense. And the credits, the goal is not basically to cover your damages as a result of a system being down, but more to create an incentive as to ensure compliance with these rates. And then the amount, obviously, will depend upon potentially your leverage or what can be accepted. Obviously, a customer will want to have something as strong as can be, while the vendor will try and lower the credits as much as they can. If the availability rates is constantly failed or is below a certain threshold, then you may have what is called termination events. Meaning that if, for instance, you are below 95% in a month, you may consider that as a termination event entitling the customer to terminate the agreement. On the other hand, you may say, okay, if you have less than 98%, maybe three times in a row, or four times over the year,
This is also considered potentially a termination event entitling me to terminate the agreement. But this is then obviously a question where you need to see what the supplier is capable of providing you, if there is anything provided or not, which obviously might make a distinction. So the second criterion, which is not typical in SLA on a vendor side, is the calculation of the response time. What is the response time? It is the time taken for a web page to be displayed on the screen once you have clicked. Okay. And for obvious reasons, as I will indicate, the vendors are quite reluctant to make any commitment on that because they say, well, we have no control end-to-end. The response time may depend upon several factors that are independent on us, such as a power outage, slowing down of the system, even your data center location. And if you are in Singapore, obviously, the latency will take more time. But customers, if they are rather big, they will try and say, okay, you need to make sure that no matter the period of the time when we use your service, typically if it's Christmas period for an e-commerce platform, obviously you will have more users, likely, that should not be a factor to slow down your system, and they will want to try and get a commitment. Typically, you normally expect from an industry standpoint that you should have an average response time below 1 second between the time you click and the display of the web page. Similarly, you will also measure the periodicity. Is it monthly, quarterly? Both can be found. And there again, you will try and get credits for a failure of an average response time, typically lower than the one for the availability. But you normally try to get something as well. In my, at least, experience, I have never met termination events for an average response time failure. This might be considered at a certain point as a downtime. For instance, if your web page takes more than 5 seconds to be displayed, you may say, well, this is an unavailability of the service, potentially a material breach of the contract, but I have never seen any structured termination events around that. Next point, the release. So these are key when actually you have on-premise solutions. Typically, when you are a big customer, a multinational company, if you have two regular updates, upgrades, etc., it's actually very difficult for them to roll them out globally. And if you have, I don't know, 5 or 6 upgrades in a year, a multinational company may take not weeks but months to roll out a certain version of your product. So if you have 5 in a year, they are just unable to cope with this this roadmap. And so what usually they will say, and they say, okay, you can have. We want you to have 1 major upgrade per year, because this shows continuous improvement on your side. But you should not have more than 3 minor, for instance, upgrades per year, because then we cannot follow. Similarly, they will say, okay, we expect you to have a full support on your SLA, not only for the latest version of your product, but also for version minus 1 or 2, typically. So that we are not left out and say, hey, hey, guys, but you did not roll out our latest version. You are running on 2 prior versions, so you do not have any support anymore. So you want to make sure that you are also covered for prior versions and not the latest one. If you are a big customer, and this might be true also actually for cloud, you will ask for a roadmap of your vendor to say, okay, where do you target to go in the next 12 months? And this is important because I did not mention that in the slides, but it's mentioned in the paper. What can be critical is rebundling of a software or of a SaaS. Because basically, you usually get some product based upon certain functionalities that you consider will meet your needs. And if suddenly the vendor, for a strategy or whatever point of view, decided in the next version to remove certain functionalities that you are interested in, obviously on a cloud base, they are automatically rolled out. And so you may find yourself, if you do not try to protect yourself against that, in a situation where you have subscribed to a given product, and then, I mean, in a later upgrade, suddenly some functionalities you were keen to have been removed. And so you want to ensure that there is ideally a warranty that the product will not be materially decreased in terms of its functionalities, performance, or that these functionalities will always be maintained during your subscription period. Or, if you have strong leverage, that potentially the successor product will be included in your subscription. But that's a tough call to have, obviously. So this is for the release. In terms of management of the incidents. So the first thing, if you are a big customer, is to say first, okay, how should the responsibilities be allocated? You probably know that you have L1, L2, L3 support. L1 being basically an end user having a problem with the tool. Should that be addressed internally? Or is everything outsourced to the vendor? If you are a big company, usually you will try and do the L1 yourself, potentially L2 after having been trained by the vendor, and only the L3 technical issues require some true expertise are escalated to the vendor. But there again, it really depends. You have different channels of communication. Obviously, a ticketing system is quite standard. However, if you have a critical issue, that we call P1, you may say, well, the ticketing system is not good enough for me. I want to be able to give you a call and have someone picking up the phone and saying, yes, guys, we are working on it right now. So look at the channels of communication and how they are contemplated in an SLA. Availability of the support is also an important point. Obviously, you may try and get a 24/7. But, I mean, this only makes sense for business critical services. Obviously, this comes at a price. And in most instances, you do not necessarily need that. Or you may want to get that only for a critical issue like a P1. Alternatively, what you have is a 24/5. So only during the business days, but you get a 24. Or 8/8, so only during the business days and the business hours. And what happens typically if you have a worldwide support 24/7 is that it's in line with what is called the follow the sun principle, meaning that if you are in Europe, in the zone, once the sun goes down, goes back to the East Coast, then it will go back to the West Coast, etc., etc. So you have a follow the sun principle for your support. Other issue might be the language. If you are working with different zones, that can be potentially tricky. The priority levels, you have a lot of metrics you can find, all indeed different depending upon the vendor. You can have P1, P2, P3, P4, up to P5. I've never seen more. And then you can have different factors coming into play to assess whether it's a P1 or P2. Am I affected on a worldwide basis? Only in a country, but all my sites within a country. Does it affect only one site, only one user, etc., etc., etc. So all these metrics is obviously key. And the question is, who decides upon the level of the priority? So typically, the customer will start, obviously, by raising a ticket, assessing it himself, if it's a P1, P2, or P3. But then the vendor will have to reassess. And one difficult case is when the vendor both provides infrastructure, so IaaS, and the application running on the infrastructure. Because for the clients, it's not always easy to find out where the issue lies. Is it at the infrastructure level or is it at the application level? And in that case, if you have a ticket raised on the infrastructure level, you should expect the vendor to do the triage of the ticket and say, well, we have made our root cause. It's not an issue at the application level, it's in the infrastructure level, and we have a dedicated team for that, and the ticket will be rerouted directly, internally, to within the vendor. But it should not be up to the customer to manage that, at least in my view. So for all these priority levels, you usually expect to have a response time. And by response time, it's not only an automatic acknowledgement of receipt, saying that, yes, your ticket is important to us, we will work on that. No, you expect someone to pick the call and say, OK, guy, we have noticed that, we are working on it. Obviously, there again, the response time will depend upon your leverage, upon the sophistication of the vendor, et cetera, et cetera. As a customer, you try to get resolution time and commitment as well. But quite logically, vendors are quite reluctant to do that because they say, hey, guys, without having carried out a root cause analysis, how can I know what the problem is and how can I make any commitment on the timing? So it's quite common that you agree to at least maybe have a workaround, okay, a temporary workaround within a given timeline, or at least what is called a restoration time of the system, and then to say, okay, we will agree in good faith about the timing to have a definitive fixing of the problem. If you have critical issues like a P1 or P2, you may ask for regular updates as well and say, okay, we just don't want to be in the blue because, you know, our operations are not running while the system is down. And so we want to be updated on an hourly basis, on a daily basis, etc., about what's going on and where you stand. Similarly to availability or response time, you will have certain targets, either minimum or expected. And you say, OK, we expect you to resolve maybe all the P1 issues that we may have, 90% of the P2, et cetera, et cetera. So this, again, is a matter potentially of discussion, but needs to be taken into account when you review an SLA. Again, you may have some credits in case of failures, and potentially, I mean, some failures may also trigger termination events or be considered a material breach, contractually speaking. Okay, I think that's all I wanted to say on the incident management incident. And to finish it, governance. So SLAs should ideally not be static, but rather dynamic. And so you should have periodic SLA review meetings to assess certain KPIs, such as the availability rates that have been obtained, the response time that has been achieved, how many tickets did I have? Was it a P1, P2, P3, etc.? How many have been solved? In how long? And so you try to build around that, if you can, a continuous improvement plan to enhance and improve your SLA over time. Obviously, if you have the leverage to do that, then you could potentially may have an escalation path as well. So this is, in a nutshell, and yeah, I'm on time, okay, and relatively quickly, the salient points, I would say, of an SLA to be taken into account and looked at rather carefully, because indeed there is no standard as such. It is correct that it is relatively difficult to negotiate them, but as you can see, I mean, this may make a big difference from a business standpoint and operationally if you choose one vendor or not, depending upon what they offer you in terms of performance and monitoring of that performance. So I'm done. Thank you.
Merci beaucoup, Monsieur Gérand. J'ouvre les possibilités de poser des questions ou de contredire. Bereits eine Frage.
So I follow the English path for the language. Do you have practical or experience or recommendations for introducing recovery time objectives and recovery point objectives in an SLA?
So recovery time objective, you mean there is a P1 issue?
Sorry. if the service is completely down, that from that moment you have X minutes or hours to be up again. That's the RTO. And then the RPO defines how many data can be lost.
It's again a matter of leverage, to be honest. The customer, if you are a big customer, let's say, it can be the require that the data balance is not more than 12 hours for a compatible installation. And then the system back, there is no standard. Because it really depends upon the issue. So usually they will say, you should try and have it in 4 hours again, but yeah, I would say you need to be quite big to be able to travel.
It's something different. It would mean to be back on the last stable state. So, okay, replaying the backup.
Okay. So I have no experience on that. The data loss is 12 hours, but
Yeah, if you like to have a view of the market, order this book, and there's a table in it, and it's all in it. It's the market.
Damit ist auch noch ein kleiner Kurs in Marketing mitgegeben. Andere Fragen?
In the previous session, we learned that most of these services are highly standardized, industrialized. So you have some players on the market like Azure Cloud, and they have their model of availability, whether it's per month, per year or day, and all that stuff. And you suggest to negotiate individual SLAs. So I think that would not work with these big players in reality. So do you suggest having some enterprise in the middle that works as an insurance and wants a premium for assuring you that stuff, that then they gamble whether it's okay or not? Or how should this work?
Honestly, I don't think you would. But you're right. I mean, if you negotiate against Google, Microsoft, no matter your side of the customer, they will not change for you. So then it's a business decision to say, okay, this is considered satisfactory. Typically for Google, honestly, Google Analytics, etc., it's not operational critical, so it's not a big deal. Of course, if you run on Azure, that's more critical, and then you need to really make a good assessment. But if there are points that you feel uncomfortable, Microsoft is not going to change for you. So then you need to say, okay, to make a risk assessment and say, is that acceptable or not? And what happens typically is that they give their call and they say, for us, it's acceptable. It's not acceptable. And if it's not acceptable, then it's the business who sign up and your service. I would say for Azure, AWS, it's not a big deal, but you're right. But depending upon the provider, it can. But depending upon your side as well, even if you are in a cloud-based environment, you can still at some point certainly not for players like.
Damit wären wir eigentlich bei der Umkehrung des öffentlichen Beschaffungswesens. Es ist nicht die öffentliche Hand, die ausschreibt, sondern wir haben offene, relativ transparente Angebote von Cloud-Anbietern und vielleicht kann die öffentliche Hand in diesem Angebot etwas finden. Mal schauen, ob das mit dem öffentlichen Beschaffungswesen aufgeht. Ganz herzlichen Dank, Professor Giron. Herzlichen Dank Ihnen allen, dass Sie dabei waren und aktiv dabei waren. Ich habe überhaupt keine Spur gemerkt von der Verdauung, sondern ganz im Gegenteil, sehr aufmerksames Publikum. Und das ist dank dieser super Referenten. Herzlichen Dank den Referenten. Sie haben noch ein Glas Wein verdient.